Okay, this is a work that came out of the Wingspread Conference. Now, the Wingspread Conference was held last year in Racine, Wisconsin, to bring together persons in the family court field, in the family courts, and persons in the advocates committee community, some of the leading spokespersons and researchers and policymakers and administrators that have been at loggerheads over custody in domestic violence cases. And we had a hard several days hammering out some of our differences. The two groups that sponsored this were the National Council of Juvenile and Family Court Judges, which was largely, we thought, representing the advocate's position on domestic violence, and the Family Court, the Association of Family and Conciliation Courts, that was representing more or less the family court judges, attorneys, mediators, custody evaluators' position. And there was a lot of concern about the fact that we seem to be getting a one-size-fits-all model regarding domestic violence, with a reaction, a knee-jerk reaction to it, which I won't go over because we've been discussing this for this whole day, what's been going on. And subsequently, members of this group, we accomplished a lot, and there's a report coming out in the July issue of Family Court Review, which summarizes what we accomplished, together with a series of papers that have been developed since then. In fact, what they did was they paired each of us that were representatives, kind of representing each of the communities, to write different papers. And Joan Kelly and Michael Johnston have written a very rich paper on differentiating types of domestic violence. And myself and Peter Jaffe, who have been seen as sort of at loggerheads, although I didn't think so, that people seem to have seen that, were paired to talk about parenting plans. And there were others that were paired to talk about Loretta Fredericks, and others that were paired to talk about the dispute resolution method that should be used in domestic violence cases. When should mediation be used, for example? What other kinds of methods of dispute resolution should you use in these cases? So this is the paper that was written. This is the material that came out of the paper that will be published in July. And let's get into it. As you know, high conflict and violent families in family court that are disputing custody and visitation of their children, there's a lot of mutual distrust going on. There's fear, anger, blaming. There's polarized positions and views of one another. And you put in top of that allegations of domestic violence and child abuse or neglect, and it is incredibly perplexing. Oops, I just went across that. This is an example of some of the data that shows you the extent to which there is in these cases. These are three different samples. The black column represents families that have actually abducted their children. It was a study that we did. And this is neglect, physical, sexual abuse, substance abuse, domestic violence, and allegations of crime between the parents. You can see how it goes up to about domestic violence, by the way, is about 70 to 80%. And litigating families, that is the high conflict ones that couldn't solve their disputes through mediation, which is mandated in California courts, are the bright blue ones in the middle. And that's very high, very high. And then the mediating families, those simply that are registering a disagreement, many of whom resolve their disputes in family court, are also pretty high. What we've got here is allegations are very, very prominent about abuse, neglect, domestic violence, substance abuse. And so the questions are these allegations, do they have a basis in fact? Are they exaggerated? Are they maliciously fabricated? Is it that just both one of the parents have some kind of emotional or mental illness, or are they character disorders? And even if there is all of that, to what extent is there sufficient evidence to prove, either by preponderance of evidence or by without, of course, we need a higher level in criminal court, but at least in family court you need preponderance of evidence. If not, what are you going to do with cases where you don't substantiate, but there's still these suspicions going on? Now, when the evidence is major, when the violence is major, and it's very clear cut what to do, you might have limited resources, maybe difficult to do it, but it's very clear what you have to do. But so much of what is seen in family court is perhaps less serious looking. It may be an isolated incident. It looks like it's mutually inflicted. Or it's simply, as I said, not able to be substantiated one way or another. It's been behind closed doors and nobody knows what really happened. So I want to talk about, very briefly, I want to review the research that distinguishes the different types of patterns of domestic violence, very briefly. And then I want to spend the time on how we need to think about screening and assessments for the different levels and types of domestic violence that we see. How to substantiate these claims and what research says about substantiated rates. I'd like to talk about that a bit. And then spend most of the time on principles and guidelines for deciding then who needs what kind of a parenting plan. And when do you shift from one parenting plan to a less restrictive one? What do we need? And finally, just hit the problem of resources, which we know are huge in these cases. What to do when resources are lacking? Now, this is something that has already been gone over somewhat in this earlier stages today, which I'm pleased about. And that is, the research is very clearly making a distinction now. And I think the clearest cut distinction is made between the first two categories. There's a lot of data to support that what we call here a coercive controlling violence, that's just a name for it, it may not be the one you like, but it's the same as violence that is accompanied by a coercive control. It's also what is typically known as battering, thought of as battering, or intimate terrorism. We're talking about the same thing virtually. It's that group of violence. We know, we'll talk a bit more about distinguishing these in a minute. Situational couple violence, also called conflict instigated or common couple violence, is what we largely see, that Murray Strauss and Linda was talking about today. A huge number of couples are like that. Those are the two patterns that have been most clearly distinguished. Violent resistance, a violent response to being abused, is of course acknowledged, but the amount of research on it is very limited, and it's very difficult to distinguish it from other forms of abuse. And finally, in the separating samples, in the divorcing samples, we also want to pull out separation-instigated violence, which is a time-limited reaction to trauma of the ending of the marriage. We acknowledge that there's little research on this. There's my own and Wallerstein and Kelly's research. But if you want to look at the way in which people behave during separation times, it is distinctly different. I think a lot of it has been included in situational couple violence in previous research, but I think there's something distinctive that goes on about this, and it warrants a different look, a different consideration. These are just the research articles that support some of these distinctions. Those distinctions, by the way, are very clearly laid out in this new paper that's by Joan Kelly and Michael Johnson, that's going to be published in Family Court Review 2008, September. July, I'm sorry. Okay, let me go over this a bit more clearly. What we mean by a coercive controlling violence is the pattern of control and domination that's asserted by a primary perpetrator, inducing varying degrees of fear, intimidation, and submission in a victim. Through physical violence and threat of threats to self and to the children or to the loved ones, and also includes these other elements, verbal and emotional abuse, not all of them, but any of them, attacks on self-esteem, insistence on being the sole authority in multiple domains, having the say in social, financial, child-rearing decisions, and isolating and restricting the victim from outside contacts, often with jealousy and rage reactions and high degrees of suspicion. And after separation, the use of legal disputes to continue to attempt to control and punish. Also, of course, sexual coercion, rape, marital rape, partner rape. And this is these are very clearly distinguished, but most obviously, in shelter populations, in criminal court samples. And indeed, as you heard, they are primarily males. I'm not going to go into figures again. I don't want to argue whether it's 95% or 85% or whatever, but we just distinguish them as primarily males. But there are both male and female types. And I think that I'm not, I think that these are the features of it. For the males, they are usually physically stronger and exert more power and control. They can exert greater physical and sexual abuse and cause more serious injuries by stint of their physical ability to do so. They certainly induce more fear. They are much more fearful. The women are much more fearful of the male CCV than the female is of the male. And I believe they're more likely to control in multiple domains. They have more frequent and severe, they can escalate over time, and they become acutely dangerous at the time of separation. Altogether, there's much more social condemnation of male violence in general, and so they're more likely to be reported to authorities, so they turn up in police records. They turn up in police reports, I should say. They turn up in hospitals, in emergency rooms where their victims are taken for injuries. But however, there are female terrorists to a less extent. It's a very strong word, terrorism, and we felt that we wanted to drop that term because we felt the family court judges and others reacted to it as a very emotionally arousing term. But it's essentially the group we're talking about. But it ranges in severity. There's a lot more minor violence going on by these, although they intimidated the male victims and they intimidated the children. Well, they often embarrassed the men who often just withdrew. These are the group of females who are most clearly identified where they are the primary perpetrator and the male does not ever, he's been taught you'd never hit a woman, and his response is virtually to back off and withdraw or to at least just only act to defend themselves, like fend her off, maneuver the situation so she and he did not get hurt, but often just backed off and became submissive and over-intimidated, embarrassed. This kind of violence was often, as I mentioned, less lethal. It was more minor in terms of there was lots of scratching and hitting, but sometimes and ramming with a car, threatening with a knife or a gun was getting much more serious. When they picked up a weapon, it often got quite serious. It was not taken as seriously. It was often seen humorously as. And often it was justified as responding to or preempting, I felt he was controlling me. Well, there was very little indication that he was, but that was her claim.
Jen?
Yes.
Do you recall what data was marshaled to support the assertion that that controlling couple violence is primarily male? What the quality?
Yes, I want to be clear that I'm not just talking about the control aspect of it. I'm talking about the domestic violence together with the control.
Yes.
Yes, well, I think you better, there is a huge amount of data. It's all the Michael Johnson data on intimate terrorism and is primarily used to support it. Okay. So I'm just reviewing at this point the what's in another paper, and I didn't want to get caught up on proportions or percentages, and I think people are up to here with stats, but I think just the general thing is that one is more male, is probably more likely to be male, but we don't know yet, you know. Situational couple violence is also mutual blaming and hostility, over specific issues that then escalated into physical struggles, physically violent struggles. People with limited problem solving skills, people who are got some anger management problems or just explode fairly easily, and this is the way they see the problems being resolved. How else are you to sort of solve something other than to push and shove? In fact, it's almost cultural in certain families that they get very coercive, and it goes on between parents both ways, and it goes on with the children. Refusal to submit to one another's rules or demands. They're not more powerful than one another. That's very clear, and they are not more fearful, or they're equally fearful of each other. And after separation and divorce, you can see them being, both parties will initiate legal actions and dispute the issues. And this is clearly both male and female perpetrated, sometimes one and sometimes the other, and they're seen largely in our community samples and in the larger divorcing population on the whole. Those are the folks we see. In fact, we don't see a lot of intimate terrorists that come and claim custody of their children, not necessarily if they've been caught up with the legal system. I think they usually try other methods like abducting their kids and other more sociopathic ways of dealing with it. And they intimidate their women so much so that the women wouldn't even ask for custody, you know, because they know it would set him off. Yes?
When you're describing ones that are couples that are, or offenders that are coercive controlling funds, that really sounds to me like women who are borderline personality disordered. And I see a lot of women that have borderline personality disorder that are in relationships with men that are generally high functioning but fairly passive.
Yeah. Yeah, I wasn't going to get into that. I think the very likely you could easily give an explanation of that to them. I have some.
I've worked with a lot of women who've done some really awful stuff.
Yeah, and it's often associated with substance abuse as well. But we'll get into that in a minute. And then, of course, you have violent resistance to being abused, it's self-defense when they are being used, protecting their children, protecting a pet being abused. It's an attempt to stop the abuse, to attempt to preempt a partner's violence because they saw it coming. I've seen that again and again. Most female violence has been interpreted as this, but as explained today, there's little research on it except in samples of victims who have killed their abusers. And that seems to be about two-thirds male and one-third female who kill their abusers. But the proportion that are truly violent resistors versus violent women is very difficult to sort out at this point. And finally, I wanted to mention there's a separation-instigated violence where there's one or two violent episodes only around the time of the separation or the custody dispute, and there's no history. The distinguishing feature here is that there's no history of violence in that relationship, and there's no history of coercive control, and there does not appear to be an imbalance of power in the previous relationship. So it's acute reaction to a traumatic separation, the sudden discovery of a new lover, a sudden leaving, their world comes tumbling down. And if anyone's seen the old movie called The War of the Roses, you know, perfectly sane and well-socialized and competent, effective people in the real world can enter into a situation or relationship time warp of some kind, and they become crazy, psychotic, if not bizarre. Intense feelings of bewilderment and loss and shame accompany these. And these folks, that was the interesting thing about it, that they often felt ashamed, and they were in the privacy of a counseling situation, were much more honest about what happened. But we found that those folks had a diminished parenting and co-parenting capacity. It's very, it was time limited. Both males and females, usually the person who was left, was the one who would initiate this kind of violence, a desperate reaction. It is just seen so people will do such crazy things at the time of separation that you that it is very distinct. Now, the question is then, how does this translate into parenting program, parenting plans after divorce? How are we going to jump from this kind of typologies that have been emerging to thinking about differently classifying these families and looking at them? The problem is that no instruments yet exist to reliably differentiate between any of these types of these violence, these four types of violence, or any other type of violence. We have just got no assessment tools to make these distinctions that are in any way, and this paper that I'm going to present today is an attempt to begin to develop that. And we don't have any really any good research that matches the type of violence to the type of parenting. I think we can make a, we did make a fairly good case in the paper for some of the these intimate terrorists to be truly very dangerous to their children as well as, and to be very poor parents and to have a lot of features that were of great concern, which I'll go into in a minute. But a lot of the domestic violence has not been connected well with the parenting. So in the absence of that, what can you, what there's huge problems. First of all, there's the problem of if you go into trying to use this information to develop parenting plans without any good assessment tools, you've got the problem of misdiagnosis, which of course the advocates are very worried about. A particular problem of misdiagnosis is confusing a separation-instigated violence with a intimate terrorist who has long subjected his partner to such fear that she has, there's not been any physical violence for years, but she is so afraid of him or her that she's not going to do anything that would jeopardize or so that the first instance of obvious violence is at the time of separation when he becomes truly dangerous, becomes violent. If that is seen as separation instigated violence, you might have miscalculated very a potential lethal situation with something that's quite benign. So first of all is the huge danger of misdiagnosis of something that could be very dangerous. The other thing is the other side of the coin. Treating someone like they're extremely dangerous and interfering with their civil rights there to have a normal relationship with their children and put them at great disadvantage from this point on in having that normal relationship is another a serious problem if you make the other problem of misdiagnosis. The third one, I think, is just a third issue around trying to use these types right now as determining of differentiating and determining parenting plans is the fact that I think it would give the family attorneys a field day in court as they dispute with one another about whether this is a coercive controlling or whether this is an intimate terrorist or, I mean, you know, same, those are the same thing, or whether this is a common couple violence or whether this is situational, with different experts being pulled up, having different definitions, different views. It would be, you know, a huge mess. So what to do in this situation? What we did, what we're trying to do is we want to say, let's talk about, instead of types, What dimensions are relevant to custody and access planning? And can we that are embedded in these types? And I'll show you how you can actually put the dimensions together to in a useful way in a moment that we connect it. We call this the P5 screening. It's actually a P3 screening in the paper, but I've made it a P5 screening. These are the P's that you've got to assess: potency, pattern, then there'll be primary perpetrator of the violence, parenting problems of both parents, and the perspective of the child. Let me go back. The potency of the violence is the first dimension. Think of these five factors as being, think of screening and assessment as being an iterative and cumulative process. And when you think about screening, you say, screening for what? What am I trying to screen for? And I suggest you're trying to screen for three things by the time. And these are things that you have to do step by step. First screening is for dangerousness, for safety. That's the first element. You can't do anything before you can determine that. The second screening that you have to do is for what kind of a treatment does this family need? What kind of a method of dispute resolution and what kind of interventions or services do they need? And the third is, what kind of parenting plan should they be able to manage? So the potency element of it screens for danger. The potency of violence is the degree of severity or dangerousness or the risk of serious injury or lethality. It indicates the level of threat and the need for immediate protective measures for the child, for the family, and restraints that need to be put in place. The pattern of violence, which is the next P, is really the history, looking at the history of using violent tactics and coercive control. What is the pattern within this family? Is there a pattern? And it indicates the degree of stress and trauma that's gone on in the family over a longer time, or whether it's just a recent thing. The potential for future violence, because the best indicator of future violence is past violence. It also suggests some of the contributors or causes, because if it's associated with drug taking or alcohol use, or if it's associated with a mental illness, then it tells you what kind of prognosis there is, and it tells you what kind of treatment programs might be effective. It also, in what rehab. So that's the pattern. The pattern tells you the level of damage that might have been done and what needs to be done to start putting that family in place again. The primary perpetrator, the third piece, indicates which parent, of course, is more likely to be deficit in parenting skills, whose access needs to be restricted, who is more able to provide a violence-free home. And that might be, both parents are equally problematic. But we've got to do a screening for primary perpetrator. The last two are obvious, perhaps. Parenting problems of both parents varies greatly. Generally, the controlling and coercive violence is much more disturbed. Our research found they were much more disturbed parents than the situational couple violence. And the separation in instigated violence was the least likely to have parenting problems over a long term. And finally, we can't leave the child out of this. Children's voices, children's perspectives, children's experiences need to be taken out. What are the risks and benefits, wishes and fears regarding access for them? So let me go over. This is now the screening instrument that we're suggesting. And I'll go over the indicators of each of these P's. By the way, there is you are going to get all of this on your free disk. So all of these things will be there, because it's a lot of material. So it's better to let this stuff flow over you, particularly when you get to these. I put them on one screen because I want it to be something the judge could just put up in front of them. So this was intended to be as practical and as simple in some respects as something that a judge could use from the bench or a screener. It's supposed to be a screening thing rather than an assessment tool. But of course, so something they could have there, and they just go through this checklist. This is the first set of them. To indicate the potency or the risk, threats and fantasies of serious harm, homicide and suicide. That, of course, is always a red flag. Do they have weapons? Do they have the means to accomplish their fantasies? Like you do a suicide risk assessment, you do that. The extent of prior abuse and serious injury, of course, is always an indicator. But remember that sometimes lethal violence can come out of nowhere. And you've also, and I've got a set of things that you'd look for, and in fact, the next two things are indicators of something that'll come out of nowhere. Where they have a history of mental illness, especially a thought disorder, where there's a severe personality disorder or a psychotic paranoid state. They have no self-insight, and they could snap. And the other important indicator is when they become obsessed with and possessive about the partner, stalking, hostage talk taking, holding the person, not letting them go, calling them constantly, hour after hour after hour, getting these frantic, obsessive calls are not a good sign. So they may not have been violent before, but they could have these other indicators. And then you look for the triggers and escalators, things like the drug and alcohol use. Are they currently using drugs or alcohol, which indicate that their ability to control their impulses is poor? Are they got a high degree of both depression and rage? And lastly, is there been a recent stressor, typically it's a separation. We all know that intimate terrorists and very high risk cases, they are very dangerous at the time of separation. Or are there other things like a loss of job, or have they just been told by the judge that they have lost custody? These are the indicators of potency. The pattern of violence. The overt indicators, of course, are the history. Now we're looking at what's been going on over the past, the history of violence. What kind of threats have they made in the past? Frequent calls to the police, lots of neighbors reporting, sexual coercion and rape. A very important one is disregard and contempt for authority, violation of previous restraining orders, criminal arrest record, very high risk for, that's a very good indicator, I should say, of a pattern of violence. A history of being obsessed with, not just currently, being obsessed with a partner, but a history of being controlling and obsessed with and possessive sexual jealousy and spying. And then you look for the causes and contributors that go along with this that might indicate the pattern is well entrenched, like having a very traditional male-female chauvinistic views, misogyny, substance abuse, personality disorders, and mental illness. And then that's all the obvious ones, but then the covert indicators of the pattern that we're trying to help judges and others look for in the language and of how they appear in court and the way they present would be the victim's level of fear. We know that it's not always a good indicator, but the victim can often, we have to go with some gut reactions of the victim when they know who this person is. The amount of verbal and emotional abuse that might have gone on, the attacks on self-esteem, the fact that this person is controlling everything, making all the decisions around money, time, children, etc. They're isolating and restricting the victim outside the home, and they're using legal disputes with no apparent purpose but to harass and punish when they're always in court and making things difficult for the victim parent. Okay, primary perpetrator indicators. Now this is our attempt to try to sort out if and whether there is a primary perpetrator or is it mutually, jointly perpetrated. Now we know that the verbal account of both victims and perpetrators is often suspect because it depends on who they talk to. They're not going to tell the judge, a lot of stuff, but they might say something to a confidential counselor that would be indicate something else. But whatever it is, the context in which they give a verbal account and what they tell the police versus what they tell a private counselor or what they tell a friend may be very different. So you have to be very careful about people's verbal accounts. But what you look for is some more subtle looks, things. The victim's story, the victim's story is usually much more clear, specific, and plausible. The perpetrator's account is much more likely to be very mushy. They just sort of say, "Oh, yeah, I something happened, but it was no big deal," and there's no real, you know. They should be able to give an account of what went on if they have a clear conscience about it. Yeah, if something went on. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm not saying. Deny. Well, it depends on how clear and what else the evidence. You don't take anything by one piece of evidence. I'm going to get into substantiation of claims, a whole new checklist for that soon. This is just trying to figure out what a primary perpetrator is. But one we find is usually clear and more plausible. Although in general, I want to warn that men are much more likely to deny and minimize. And I think that's because they are much more self-conscious about the violence, and they've been taught it's not okay. Whereas women say, "Oh yeah, I did that to him." So you've got to take it with a grain of salt. Women were much more clear about their violence than men were in general. But on the other hand, given that bias, there is still that I'm still looking at the plausibility of what they said. Next is the victim. Listen to the motivation. Why did they do what they did? Not just what happened, but why did they do it? And usually, unless they're very smart, which some of them are, the victim's motive or intent is often to please, placate, to self-protect, to protect someone else, to stop, to get away, to withdraw. And the perpetrator is motives is more to control and punish. She can't get away with it. He can't think he could do this and get away with it. Here the motivation is to stop. There's got to be, she or he has got to pay the price for what he did or she did. That would be a much more of a motivation for punishment. The victim is more aware of the hurt that's inflicted. They express more shame and guilt regarding their role. Now, the behavioral indicators are, the defensive wounds versus the aggressive wounds. A typical one I think you might have heard about is the woman arrives with a scratched. The man arrives bleeding all over his face, and she hasn't got an apparent mark on her, and so they arrest her for perpetrating the violence. And what has happened is that he knows exactly how to grab her by the neck and squeeze the breath out of her in a way that doesn't leave any marks. And she, with long fingernails, is clawing his face. So she ends up, that's a typical example of some of the confusions that can arise. Unless damage and injury is more likely to be inflicted by the one who has the size and physical strength, but that's not always true either. All of these things have got exceptions. I've seen the biggest, strongest men who have been victimized by women very, very small and been intimidated by them, and they are always frightened that they're going to be the one that's been charged. In fact, they are the victims. But, that's exceptions probably, but we don't know. The violence responses by a victim are proportional to the level of the perceived threat. I'll give you an example. Whereas the perpetrator responds with excessive force, there was a case where a woman and a man were having some intimate partners, were having some disputes with one another and not getting on too well, and she didn't attempt to make it up, had a lovely dinner prepared for him, and after which they had wine and dined together, and then they had sex, and just after the sex, he turns to her and says, "By the way, I had the affair with your girlfriend," or something like that, told him that he had had sex with somebody else. She turned around right there in bed and slapped his face very, very hard. He got up. He went to the bathroom and washed off, very calm, very cool, collected, came back to the bed and he punched her repeatedly and knocked her eye out. I mean, there's an example of, okay, she slapped him first, but the amount of, you know, was excessive, obviously, force and violence in response, in which case I would have called him an indicator, having that indicator of primary perpetrator. And of course, the other one is if there is true evidence of being the primary perpetrator in the past, the existence of a restraining order, especially a criminal court restraining order. A criminal court restraining order has a lot more teeth into it and is much harder to get than a family court restraining order.
I have a question.
Yes.
In that example that you gave,
yes.
Does this gentleman fall into the category of the assessment of previous,
yes.
Previous behavior, or was this just
at
one time?
No, he had a whole history. But this was an example of him being the problem. But there was a very violent and fiery relationship between them, and anyone looking at it might have said, oh, well, she just asked for that. She just slapped him right in the face. In fact, I think she made him, she gave him a pretty, you know, she hit him pretty hard. But, I mean, this was far in excess. So these are some of the indicators we're suggesting for primary perpetrator. Parenting problems, there's a whole series of them here on the... of the perpetrator or of the aggressor, they are more likely to use coercive disciplinary tactics that does amount at times to physical abuse. They alternate between being overly permissive and then rigidly authoritarian. They could be either or both. They often reverse roles with the child and be the child's best friend, and then they come down on them like a ton of bricks. There's a lot of violation of the child's emotional boundaries, perpetrating to actual perpetration of sexual abuse in some of them cases. There's a lot of emotional abuse. These are all indicators that might or might not be true. It's what you're checking off. Is there emotional abuse of the child, mind games, put downs? Do they pit the siblings against one another? Do they isolate the child socially like they did their ex-partner, their partner? Do they morally corrupt the child by encouraging immoral and criminal behavior? Has there been a child abduction or threats? So they are the usual physical evidence of being an abusive parent. And we do find a lot of evidence that most of these here correspond to the behaviors of severely coercive, controlling violence or intimate terrorists, and less so with any of the other categories. But here are some of the things that are less obvious, but give you some concern about the capacity of that of the parent who is in any way maybe a suspect, who has been violent. Minimizes or denies exposure, that the child's exposure to their violence in any way has negatively affected the child. They said that, you know, it's no big deal. He doesn't make any. He's seen this fight. He can, you know. He knows what we're like. He doesn't rolls off him like a duck off a duck's back. If they're intolerant or impatient at the child's developmentally appropriate behavior or special needs, if the child, for example, has a lot of symptoms of trauma and they don't see that the child has got any problems, and they're just impatient that that's just the other parent. Making the child dependent. If they demand and insist the child demonstrate affection, she's got to give me a kiss, she's got to give me a hug. They're intrusive of the child's emotional boundaries. Not good news. Use, of course, the child to communicate net threats and negative messages. Use the child's access to coerce or harass the parent, and they reward the child for rejecting or punishing the other parent. And we have some good data to show that these behaviors are indicative of the perpetrators of domestic violence, not the victims. They're much more likely to be the perpetrators. So this issue of, you know, is that alienating behavior is more likely to be done by the perpetrator. other covert, oh, this is the other covert integrate. They're unable to stay focused on the child. Whenever you have a, in a car, when they're talking about the child, they can't stay focused on the kid for any more than 2 seconds, and they're back onto their own problems or the problems of that other parent that's causing all the difficulties, blaming. Or they provide, these are less definitive, but they have this highly idealized, or they have almost no ability to discuss the child. Oh, he's a good kid, you know, or he's a perfect kid, not able to see the child as an individual in any way, and can't tell the child, you can't tell them about what the child's doing or interested in, or activities, achievements, or vulnerabilities, or anything. He's just a good kid. When they discuss, this is a bad news, angry outbursts, they're talking about the child's situation and they just lose it. They just emotionally just disrupt and become just angry or upset or rageful about, suddenly again it goes on to their blaming their ex-partner. Or they deny that the child feels anything but except like they feel. My child feels exactly like me. They hate that other parent, and they feel intimidated by that other parent, and they feel like they, et cetera, et cetera. So are convinced that their own child's needs are identical to their own, or fully, or the other child is nothing more than a voice piece of the other parent. Their child has no personality at all. They're completely swallowed up. Now, or finally, this is indicative of probably psychotic or of severe personality disorder. They make impulsive responses. They make odd, bizarre, or irrational remarks about the child. Like, I'm talking to this guy about his five-year-old, and he says, oh, yeah, he's great. He gets me laid with other women. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, when the women think I'm so cute with him, they just can't resist me, so I get all these offers. You know, there's a whole mix there of that father's loss of boundaries. Now, of course, the parenting problems of victims have huge problems as well, as we well know, which have not been well publicized. They're often anxious, depressed, they have PTSD symptoms, they're often using alcohol or drugs. Is this true? To numb their pain. This is another checklist. They're often preoccupied with the demands of the abuser or with the demands of the failed relationship, and just have little time for the kids, so that they're physically, emotionally exhausted, unavailable. They also have been shown, the victims, to be less warm, less and more permissive, or they also are coercively controlling with their kids, or often into role reversal, dependent upon their children. Unable to protect the child from the abuser for fear, brainwashed by the abuser. They lack confidence in their own parenting because they've been undermined for so long. And they have difficulty managing their children. We found that victims of intimate terrorist or coercive controlling violence, actually not all of them were being abused by their teenage boys. Not one exception in our data were they not being abused by their teenage boys by the time the kid was 12 or 13. And they could often act irrationally with poor judgment. So all of these things might be going on with the victim of the violence as well. Now, of course, I'm going to hit this. What I'm trying to do now is combine our thinking about some of the parenting problems that are coming about due to the high-conflict divorce, and see high-conflict divorce and domestic violence as not two different groups. I mean, when you get an 80% of domestic violence occurrences in a high-conflict sample, you cannot say you can distinguish this is a high-conflict case as this is a violent case. The fact is the dynamics of both are going on. They're two different dynamics, DV dynamics and the high conflict dynamics, but they can co-occur. And all I want to say is that for many of these folks, they are struggling with the humiliation and loss that's inherent in the divorce and the shame about being in the custody dispute, which they are using, they reacted to that by having an oscillating dependency, refusal to communicate or coordinate their parenting, and they become very suspicious and allege violence and abuse. They see the other parent as irrelevant, irresponsible, and dangerous and threatening. They use the child as a bridge, as a substitute for their ex-spouse, as a weapon. They selectively distort the child's needs. And in the worst cases, the child, in the paranoid cases, the child becomes their ally or their enemy. That is, either the child is all with me or all against me. So these are some of the dynamics that are going on as a result of the divorce on top of the general dynamics of parenting. Finally, we really need to consider the children's perspective. And I suggest a sort of a risk-benefit and assessment of each child or the children in the family. By the way, it's usually in high-conflict families, two-thirds of the case it's only child. In the other one-third of the cases, they may have more than one children. So it's this one special child that's being disputed over in the high-conflict families. So you look at that child and you say, what benefits of access should they have, and what are the risks? The benefits are, of course, the child. To what extent does this child need to feel valued and loved? But to what extent do they need to have a sense of their origins, identity, and know that other parent, and maintain a prior attachment with that other parent, or to get to know a parent that they've never known before? To what extent do we need to promote a realistic view of that other parent and get them to know that other parent has limitations and not idealize them or de-idolize them, just know that person as a person? To what extent should we ask them to develop coping skills, to be able to relate to a parent that's not an easy parent to relate to? You know, these are all potential benefits of asking them to have a relationship with that parent and provide the means of doing so. And the risks of access, of course, are always the untenable loyalty conflicts, the fact that you're putting the kid in the middle of the dispute again, that may go on and on, unremittingly, litigation. Also the unreliable contact, because a lot of these parents are so marginal in their parenting that they are kind of all in there for a while, and then they just get fed up and leave the kid and don't come back, so the kid could be subjected to periods of abandonment and then return again. You could re-expose them to further violence. And finally, the risks are the helplessness that the child feels if their voice wishes are ignored. So if they say, I don't want to see a parent, I don't want to be, I really feel very upset and I'm upset and I don't want to live, I don't even want to see them in supervised visitation. The issue is, should you give them some voice, especially at a certain age, would they do that? Which comes to the next, what is their actual response to the access arrangements that you set up? We believe that the mature and reasonable preferences of older children should be really given a great deal of honored. Especially, it takes a lot of courage to say no to a parent who has been very controlling and dominant in your life, and that sometimes a kid can only feel safe in doing that when they have separated. We think that it's important to respect the level of fear that a child has about a parent's contact. We know that a parent's level of fear is often related to their primary custodial parent's level of fear. Now, that may or may not be accurate, but the fact is that that's a very normal and developmentally appropriate thing for a little kid to be tracking the fear of their parent. And for the older kids, they may have a lot of anger that also needs to be considered when you're thinking about the access plan. And of course, those kids that absolutely get significantly emotionally and behaviorally distressed in response to the visiting arrangement that you set up, even supervised access, that should be considered when you're taking into account the kind of plan. We believe that this the three P's, especially the first three, provides you with a tentative working hypothesis as to the type of violence. Now I'm going to put the PPPs together with the types. If you have multiple indicators of high potency, really, really seriously dangerous situations, a clear pattern of violence, history of violence and coercive control, and a primary perpetrator, you probably have a case of coercive controlling violence or intimate terrorism. So if those three things come together, you're probably dealing with that, but it's a hypothesis. Because you never know, these cases you start to get, they unfold after a long time. If you have some moderate or severe potency, any of these cases can be potent at certain stages, but there's no pattern of coercive control, and there's none of those other clear indications of the intimate terrorist. There's no primary perpetrator, then you probably have a situational couple violence. With separation instigated violence, the potency is usually mild. There's no history of violence, no pattern of coercive control. It's an isolated incident by one or both parties. And a violent resistance varies depending on the level of threat of perceived violence. So multiple indicators with higher ratings, of course, signal the more difficult and high-risk cases. So you can actually, these become kind of working hypotheses that then may be played out as the case unfolds, but you've got something to go on. Okay, now let me talk about assessing credibility. I showed you the overhead that said right at the front that says there's a huge amount of violence being, family abuse being alleged. Substantiation can be very difficult, poses a great challenge for professionals, and what do we know about published studies? How are we going for time here? Okay, I'm going to cut this to be really short and you can look at it in great detail. I'll come back to the... we looked at what's... if you have any further research about this, I would like to know. This is the rates of substantiation of allegations of child abuse in family law cases, and it ranges from about 50% against fathers, 41% against mothers, to about the lowest levels of the amount of substantiation of the child abuse allegations is 50% in some cases, and it goes down as low as 22% in other states' cases. So it ranges between about 22 to 49%. And this is the studies in United States, Canada, Australia, and ours in the another one here in the San Francisco Bay Area. So all of these cases are small, non-representative samples with different definitions of what it takes to substantiate. And there's a whole paper written on that if you're interested. Now let me go back and show you rates of substantiation of DV allegations in family law cases. I could only find two studies that looked at the attempt to substantiate the allegations, and that was 44 Canadian family law cases where they found, not very many cases, it's very small, but they were all written decisions, and they substantiated 74% against the men, only two cases against the women. One out of two was substantiated. You know, you can't do 50% statistics on that. It doesn't mean anything. Interestingly, we had another 120 custody evaluation cases in the San Francisco Bay Area. We have substantiated 74% of them against the men and 50% against the women. Now, if you've got any other data on substantiations, can you let me know later on about that? So what do we have here? We have... huge amount of, we've got a set of criteria here about how to substantiate that we write up pretty clearly in the book, so in our chapter, so I'll just go over it pretty quickly. First of all, you look for objective verification in police and medical reports, self-admissions, eyewitness evidence. You look for corroboration of aspects of the report, from neighbors, teachers, citizens, babysitters, and expert testimony. You look at the timing of the disclosure. We'd certainly raise more questions when this disclosure has occurred at the time of separation and only at the time of a custody dispute, because it does raise questions about motivation. But on the other hand, there are some good reasons sometimes for people to keep something hidden for some time until they're encouraged. It can go either way. We don't want to have a prejudice one way or the other. You look at the meaning of the violence within the cultural context of the family, with some acts of violence being terribly demeaning and other terrible aspects of violence in our culture that would seem bad are taken for granted in other cultures. So there's a lot of cultural differences in terms of the meaning of the violence, the context in which it occurs. This is an interesting one, and that is, when you look at something, you look at the lack of disconfirming reports by credible others. What do I mean by that? That is, there are other credible others in the house that should know, older children, adults sharing the home, the abuser's relatives, who know a lot about what went on, but are keeping mum. There's an allegation of violence, and they're saying, oh no, it didn't, they're not saying, oh no, it didn't occur, they're just not saying anything. So it's the dog that didn't bark sort of phenomena. And then, of course, you look at the psychological status of the alleged abuser, the diagnosis of a severe personality disorder. Of course, especially one that's associated with violence, might indicate that this is more valid. And the psychological status of the alleged victim, particularly reality testing problems and hysterical, histrionic tendencies and things like that, might be indications that that person is not being very credible.
If you're using credibility, wouldn't you run the same psychological tests on the alleged?
Oh, yes, but I'm just pointing out the ones that indicate that this would substantiate this, and this would not substantiate it. Oh yes, you'd use the same personality test, but these are the indicators. I know I'm going awfully fast at this present time, and because I'm short of time, yeah.
Do you have anything about head injury or brain injury that might make people more violent?
That would go into the diagnosis of, you know, if they've had a brain injury here, like we're going to see, I think, a lot of PTSD coming through with the brain injuries that are coming through from Iraq now. We are going to see a huge amount of this and associated with it. You know, that would certainly raise issues that this might have occurred, and there is some validity to it. Okay. Now, of course, whereas we told you that we can substantiate between 25 and we can only substantiate between 25 and 50% of abuse allegations against children, and about 50 to 75% of abuse allegations against domestic violence. What do we do with the unfounded cases? It should be the origin of unfounded child abuse allegations and domestic violence allegations. Some may be valid, simply lack evidence. We have to keep that in mind. Some are honest misunderstandings of a parent, so no longer communicating. The kid comes home with disturbed behavior, and there's an assumption that they misinterpret. The family social stresses, there's traumatic separation and betrayal of trust, and tribal warfare occurs, and the families separate into these two different distinct camps in which they are building these different social realities, and they're confirming, oh yeah, I think he's that kind of person. Like, she goes off to her therapist who says, I think he's abusing the child, and his therapist says, I think she's alienating the child, and you've got family members lining up on each side with a different interpretation of the world. And of course, when they enter the court system that's so intent on proving that one's right and one's wrong, these kind of abuse allegations can become much more difficult to substantiate and leave everyone wondering what's going on. We talked about distortions that are due to the humiliation and the loss and the severe personality disorders. So there's a whole lot of reasons for people to have these misunderstandings, misperceptions, and defensive distortions, and an adversarial system that invites that kind of polarization. But we do find that in the research, there are very few indications that there is deliberate fabrication, where somebody is simply deliberately making up the story. A lot of these people have honestly held but erroneous conceptions for various psychological and more benign reasons for unfounded allegations. The point we want to make is that about those is that you can't dismiss them. These families are just as troubled, and we've got to decide that's got to be a part of our parenting plan decision. Okay, so let's get to the crux of it. And that is the where we're trying to get with this. There's a continuum of options for parenting plans. You think of all of the range from primary parenting, where one parent gets sole control, suspended, or supervised access to the parent that's been deemed to have problems. There's parallel parenting with monitored or neutral exchange, with sole or divided legal and physical custody for a whole range of people. And there's co-parenting, where you truly get people to share legal, sole, or shared physical custody. These are the range that you have. Now, how can we slot people into these according to the let's talk a bit about which of them. The primary parenting, the provisions for that are sole legal and physical custody to a non-violent parent normally, all other things being equal, which then rarely are because there could be other issues with a non-violent parent other than the violence. But if it's a that this would be the criteria for a violence-only case, you need a detailed court order with a very explicit time, dates, places of exchange, who is the supervisor, the behavioral objectives for them to graduate from supervised visitation to other forms. You need safety provisions for the victim parent and the child. You need support services may be offered for to the person who is the perpetrator, but victims are usually empowered by respecting their self-determination. And you might have court-ordered treatment rehab for the abuser. This would be the elements that would go into a primary parenting order.
So this is only one parent
file. This would be where you found one. I'll tell you who it's appropriate for in a minute. I'm just saying this is one option you have. Who is this for appropriate for in a minute? Supervised access would be, so that kind of a plan with supervised access would be appropriate for someone who is judged high on potency. If someone is acutely dangerous, and I don't care what type of violence it is, if they are judged high on potency, we suggest that for the time being, while they're high on potency, they're high risk for lethality, they should be in a supervised access at the very least. And they could be, but if they're judged, say, moderately high to fully high on all the PP ratings, especially if they are seen as one of these coercive controlling intimate terrorists, then this would be the indicator until they get treatment. If they're acutely dealing with a substance abuse problem, this is all acute and current, and mental illness, they probably need supervised access. Another case for supervised access is that it's a very ambiguous situation where there's a lot of disputes, allegations flying around and a lot of complexity. And you might, during a very short period of time, do a DV assessment and keep it under surveillance for that reason.
Would that be both parents?
Both parents. Oh, yeah, I mean, you've got to take provisions for both. If there's a history or a risk of a serious parenting problem of the abuser, that's always been the criteria for supervised visitation. There's a serious parenting problem present. And here's another case which I'll argue about in a little while, and I'll tell you why. The child is traumatized by the domestic violence or abuse, but wants and needs access to the violent parent, and this is the only safe way to do it. So generally, those would be the conditions under which someone would be doing supervised visitation. Now, when you suspend access, they're very high, they have all these features, but they're not complying with supervised order. And in addition, there are attempts or threats to abduct, seriously hurt, kill, or use the child to hurt and harass the other person in a very obvious way. They'd be convicted for murder or serious injury of a family member, and I will argue this case in a little while, you'll see, the child is persistently distressed and refuses, regardless of what can be done to help them. and a child is estranged from and unable to reconcile with a previously abusive parent. You may object to some of these, but I'll argue for them in a moment. So they're the conditions under which supervision and
just so I can understand, you have two high potency violent parents. You place them with a third party and get both parents.
Oh yes. Oh yeah. Yeah, that would be a child. This would be a case that should go into juvenile dependency court. I mean, I'm talking about both courts now. I'm not talking about just family court. This would be a case that neither parent is safe. Now, parallel parenting turns out to be a very important distinction. We have to make the distinction between parallel parenting and collaborative or cooperative parenting. And this is a parallel parenting is one in which you divide legal and sole custody in a very explicit way. You divide the time, you divide the decision-making responsibilities. You create in every possible way boundaries and separation between the parents, for example, through structured telephone access, through a timeshare schedule that requires very minimal communication, and you set them up with a whole series of protocols for how they communicate when they have to, and their etiquette at the time of the exchange, how they are to exchange the child, if and how they are to attend any child-related events, etc. It's all set out for them in a parenting plan. The court orders will explicitly detail all of these information so that everything can be very easily interpreted. And also, what are the behavioral objectives to graduate to shared parenting? How long do they have to do this before they can really do cooperative work? The goal is to sort of get these parents back into their own corners and stop the projection of blame and the attempts at control and manipulate and sabotage one another and get them focused back on their own parenting. Parenting coordinator may be necessary, but often they cannot be afforded. They may have to have anger and conflict management treatment. This is, I'm not talking about batterers treatment programs, but I'm talking about how to solve conflicts and how to, but the whole thing here is that we're stressing that we want them to adhere to a court order that has these things laid out. We are not asking them to be flexible and compromise. We want them to be able to manage the court order. And we want to be sure that they have consistent, safe childcare practice within their separate homes. Too often we found in these high conflict families, I'm doing the follow-up now 15, 20 years later after I saw these families for months, a couple of decades ago, and we found that the conflict was a smokescreen for the very poor parenting that was going on in both families. Everyone was focused on the conflict is upsetting the children, the violence, the continual sabotage. But what was going on, what I find out from these kids in their 20s, was really pretty awful kind of parenting from both parents. And so we want to get them back in their own corners and taking them responsible for their own parenting. The kind of exchange situation is monitored or neutral, but it's appropriate for parents who are good enough alone, but the threat of renewed violence and the conflict only occurs when they meet. And this is true for situational couple violence. It's true to some extent for separation-instigated violence. They need time out from each other after the trauma of the separation. And they're okay once they get in their own corners, but they are not good when they meet. We suggest that this is where you put the unsubstantiated allegations of parent spousal abuse and chronically conflicted parents so that they are protected from sabotaging and each other all the time. And also, another appropriate for this parallel parenting is really only appropriate for the older children who have. We're not recommending it for preschoolers that need a lot of coordination and care and a lot of communication of their parents with one another. So the kids have got to be old enough to be able to manage two different kinds of parenting styles in their families. And they also have to be, also has to be a time share schedule that is not going to disrupt the child's schooling and social activities. The older children, and also the children have no special needs. You know, a child that has ADD or a lot of emotional problems or a speech problem or a hearing problem or asthma or whatever, they may not be able to talk because there's just not enough communication in the parallel parenting home to make it safe and comfortable for the child. It's appropriate for moderate ratings on PPP, but there's no ongoing threat of violence. So there is the potency is down, there's no ongoing threat, and these people still need to work on their issues. Graduates from the supervised visitation who have met their objectives, have credible evidence of good progress or completion of treatment, should be able to move into parallel parenting. And finally, it is appropriate for where there's problematic behavior or distress by either the parent or the child at transitions, and we need to sort of get these parents separated and have some kind of neutral exchange, either through someone who watches the exchange or a safe place for the exchange. Finally, shared parenting with unsupervised access. We all know that this is the typical joint custody situation where you want people to kind of really communicate very fully on their childcare practices and develop routines and discipline that's consistent across their homes, to be flexible and to compromise with one another where possible. You usually want to put a court order in as a backup plan, but they are encouraged to be flexible about this. It's appropriate for people who have some capacity to communicate, resolve conflict, to trust, to respect, to remain child-focused. And that's not true of most of these families, or it's true only after they've gotten a lot of help. So it'd be low ratings on PPP, and we found this was the only group separation-instigated violence. After the crisis was passed and the trauma resolved, some of them could do this kind of work very well. They could become quite good co-parents after they'd sorted out their trauma of the separation. Others with a substantial history of successful parallel parenting and a cessation of violence and control problems also could fit into this category, but it could take a long time. Some will never graduate to it. And finally, those that are treated mentally ill people, treated substance abusers, may jump from a supervised visitation right into a co-parenting arrangement. If they were well medicated and under control with there's no reason for them to even go through parallel parenting. We think that putting people's under the restriction of supervised and access arrangements is a very intrusive intervention in the lives of families, and that should be done very carefully. They should have explicit goals with behavioral criteria that need to be met so that they can graduate and move on. They need a timely review of progress. They need to be monitored either by the family court or a designated agent to make sure that progress is done so they can move on. But don't leave them in the never-never land of something that's not working. And any resumption of unsupervised access should be contingent upon cessation of threat of the violence, credible report of successful progress, and that the children are prepared. It is absolutely crazy making for children to be put into a situation where they're told they can't see mummy or daddy because mummy's been abusive or violent, or even if they're not given any information some of the times, and then suddenly told, okay, you can see mummy or daddy now. There's no problem. You can see them. What is the child to think? They need to have proper reunification, which means that the parent also needs to accept responsibility of the violence and take steps to reassure the child that they have taken care of it and ensure measures that they are ensuring future safety. Finally, what I want to point out is that we have all these conflicting goals in our heads with these families. We want to do all of these things. We have a set of goals. We're trying to protect the children. We're trying to protect and support the safety and well-being of nonviolent or victim parents. We want to respect the right of people, the parents, to do their own thing and make their own decisions. We want to hold perpetrators accountable. We want to promote the best, most the best kind of most frequent access arrangement that we can, that's with a child, the least restrictive parent-child access arrangement, keep out of the lives of families. These are all the goals. So what do we do when they conflict so often? We suggest they begin with the goal of achieving all of those five. And when you run into conflicts, you resolve the conflict by abandoning the lower priority. Let me finish by telling you just a couple of incidents, and you can tell me what you would do under these situations, and I will tell, and we can go over what these guidelines would suggest that you do. Here's a case of a father has filed for every weekend visits, every other weekend visits with his school-aged child. His mother wants to the mother wants to have no contact. There is documented abuse on three occasions requiring the mother's medical treatment. He has been ordered and attended the batterer's treatment program intermittently. He's finished only 3 of 20 sessions. So what do you do with that case? He wants to have his access. She says, I want him to have no visits. I mean, just take these as facts, given facts. What are you going to do? Supervise visitation. What I'm pointing out there, you have to abandon. You have to hold him accountable. He won't be held accountable. You have to abandon the priority of allowing and promoting. Since he won't be accountable, he doesn't even graduate to having a least restrictive. He has to be supervised. Let me give you another one. A mother has requested permission to relocate with her preschool child across the country where she can be with her extended family. The father refuses to agree because he wants regular visitation. She has a protective order against him issued by the family court after several violent episodes. The father minimizes his abuse, refuses treatment, and insists on his rights to have regular access. Bye. Let her go? Okay. So we abandon. She has a right. He won't be held accountable. And you have to do this. He won't be held. You have to respect her to do what she wants for herself. Let me pick up one with a woman's case. A non-violent father requests every Saturday visit with his children, and his mother will not cooperate. The children's mother will not cooperate. She is the primary custodial parent and has initiated numerous violent confrontations with him, and she often blows up with her children, who are quite scared of her. The father avoids her or responds defensively and does not protect the child from her frightening tirades. What do you do? Give her. So what you do is you're trying to make him take over and ask for custody. He's not even asking for it. He's too scared of her. A lot of those cases get left because he never asked for it. This is a suggestion where one would be to get him to set up the plate and ask for custody. Another one would be to get, and if she won't take care of her violence problems, then that's where it should go. So you would be dropping this. And if she held out, she became responsible, then you might be able to get him. She would then allow him access. But they would be good. Let me pick up one where we have a child problem to finish off here. A school-aged child remains traumatized by his mother's explosive violent rages directed at several members in the past. Thank you. He now resists or refuses all contact with her. Extensive therapy and supervised visits have been ineffective. The mother has sought treatment for her alcoholism and abuse. She's been violence-free. She's done everything that she could. Now she wants to see her child. They've done reunification, and it won't work. This kid is adamant and just doesn't want to do it. He's done the counseling.
How old is the child?
He's 10.
You know, sometimes there are irreparable consequences that we can't.
Exactly. Look, allow and promote the least restrictive parent-child access that benefits the child. This child cannot use this mother right now, even though she's done a lot of work. He is so unnerved, and so he's just not old enough and with it enough. And you know, we come back to these kids, we give them therapy after therapy after therapy, and we push them into the supervised visitation. I tell you, when I've seen them down the line, they have nothing but contempt, is sometimes at least a lot of disdain for the system that told them all the time they had to go to therapy again and again for a relationship that wasn't working for them. But when they get old enough, they often come back, but they're not ready, he's not ready yet.
I just had two cases, and DV was not a problem in either case, but in both cases, one of the parents had basically disappeared from the child's life. And we tried any number of interventions in both cases, and the kids just
You've, you know,
both parents agreed, dropped
right, and we found that the children have reunited much more quickly when the parent has been allowed to back off and say, well, when you're ready. I mean, they can always encourage them to remain with Christmas presents and cards and things like continuing to pay child support and pay money for their college. That means something when the parent continues to give. And doesn't expect their pound of flesh back.
There's situational couple violence where it's pretty equivalent or mutual.
Oh yeah.
Is it helpful?
Okay, let me give you the one last one on situational couple violence then, and tell me what you do with this. This is a situation in which both parents. Oops. Let me get it right so I can be quick. Okay, both parents have filed for custody with alternate weekend visits with the other parent. They both physically fight over the management of the children. They use a lot of verbal abuse. They use a lot of corporal punishment for their unruly children. Mutual restraining orders are in place. What are you going to do with them? Well, what would you do? You'd put them into a parallel parenting arrangement. And you would send them off where? To grandma's. Yeah, you want a neutral exchange place for the kids, or a safe place of exchange. You would need to send them off to parenting classes, parenting without violence classes, and get them onto better parenting skills by themselves. But parallel parenting would be good for that one. That was the last piece I didn't get to, was what we need desperately now is to have monitoring and case management of these cases in court, and we've got to hold the courts accountable, or if they're going to put a court order in, to see that they are being properly carried out and properly watched and monitored. What we're suggesting is that we've got the pattern for these orders now. What we would like to have is like a big smorgasbord of orders already made up, so the poor judge at the hasn't got to go and reinvent the wheel every time. But given the characteristics of a case, could try out these different kind of orders with this and that and the other provisions, put them together with a asking the attorneys to carry out too some of this responsibility for putting the orders together, and then having some kind of designated agent to monitor and follow up the cases. We absolutely agree these cases have to be monitored. And what? And enforced. And therefore the court, that would mean enforcement as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. We've got the whole other issue is the shortage of resources, because we know these families are poor and unrepresented and there's no services in the community. What can you do? We could spend a whole session on that. But I think we've got to prioritize with safety planning, at least begin by, if we look at the cases that need the help, instead of dealing with all of these other cases that may easily be relegated to less severe interventions in their family lives, because they we can maybe do a better triage, is what I'm trying to get at. Thank you.